afternoon. So once I was in the Swedish Lapland with a couple of friends, and we were in a blistering snowstorm. And then all of a sudden, we saw this moose standing up there, fully covered in snow, with his head stubbornly in the wind. And for me, that was such a symbol of endurance and perseverance. As a stubborn Dutch guy myself, I can really relate to that moose. And I often think of this image when things get tough or on our initiative. My name is Fonger Ypma. I'm the founder of Arctic Reflections, and it is our mission to restore the Arctic sea ice to counter global warming. We do this, thank you. We do this by pumping water from underneath the ice, on top of the ice, to make it freeze faster and have more reflective ice in summer. So that sounds like a crazy plan, right? And it is. But it's actually more feasible than you may think, and I'll show you how. As a Dutchman, I live in a land that would hardly exist without large land reclamation efforts. And of course, people like Hansje Brinker, who put his finger in the leaking dike. I think our offshore and dredging industry has seen bigger challenges than creating sea ice at scale. This journey to look into the Arctic started in the beginning of 2021, when I decided to look into the Arctic climate and what is happening there. And the Arctic, it's the area that is covering the North Pole, and usually it's hardly noticeable on the average map of the world. It's the thing in the north. But it's actually a vast area. It's larger than the US and Canada combined. And every year in the winter, it's practically fully frozen with ice, as you saw here. But then over the summer, it actually starts melting. And by the end of the summer, there's only about 4 million square kilometers of ice left. And that used to be 7 million square kilometers only 40 years ago. And at the same time, also the average thickness of the ice has halved. I was alarmed by stories of vast methane leakages from the permafrost, the forever underground underneath the ice, because that would undo all the work that has been done already in the energy transition to which I've devoted a large part of my working life. And I was struck by the fact that the IPCC, the International Panel for Climate Change, states that by the 30s or 40s, we will experience the first practically ice-free summer in the Arctic. So by in 20 years' time, the North Pole will be open water. So unlike glaciers, such as Greenland, the sea ice is only meters thick, so it's very vulnerable to climate change. So just imagine we have 2 million of years this North Pole covered with sea ice, and in our lifetime, we'll be creating open water there. I was wondering, couldn't we just preserve that Arctic sea ice somehow? Because it has an important function both locally and globally. Locally, of course, there's like precious wildlife such as polar bears who live there and really depend on the sea ice for hunting. But also local indigenous communities really depend on the sea ice for their way of life. Next to this, the Arctic is also important for the global climate because ice reflects up to 90% of sunlight, whereas open water absorbs more than 90%. So just like wearing a white t-shirt in the summer is a lot cooler than wearing a black t-shirt. And once it starts melting, we create more open water, it will warm up and it accelerates the melting. And scientists have estimated that 25% of the temperature rise so far is due to the Earth's surface becoming darker. So the Arctic really acts as some sort of heat shield. So the reality is that this climate crisis is evolving so fast that rapid carbon emission reductions are not enough anymore to preserve the Arctic sea ice. In the Netherlands, we really like ice skating, right? I remember when I was young, I would push a chair across a frozen pond, and that's how we learned to ice skate. But unfortunately, my own kids hardly had any of these opportunities anymore. And these days, Every time the temperature drops below zero, a frantic race between villages starts to be the first ones to organize an ice skating marathon. And the so-called ice masters of these villages, they really take pride in this race. And one of the tricks they apply is applying thin layers of water every night so that the ice freezes faster. So that made me think, couldn't we do that in the Arctic and pump water on the ice in the winter when it's like minus 30 degrees, make the ice freeze faster, have more ice left in the summer? So I got really excited about this and I decided to send a friend of mine a message. I still know him from our Oxford University time, and he's a glaciologist. And within 5 minutes, I got back the answer. Oh, that sounds fascinating. Do you mean like this? And he linked to this article in The Guardian reading, could a 400 billion plan to refreeze the Arctic before the ice melts really work? So I guess I had made the classic mistake of not even Googling my own idea. The fact that this had been researched already, I actually took this as a positive sign, and this was an excellent starting point for us. So this led to a very simple concept. We can make ice by using existing ice. By pumping water on top of it, it freezes faster, and especially if you flood a snow layer that's on the ice, the snow usually acts as an insulator. So once you flood that, then it refreezes as ice again, but you also get ice growth on the bottom of the ice for free. So just like reforestation projects, where we help nature a little bit in growing trees, we could help nature a little bit in growing ice. So to know more, I decided to contact Hajo Hendrikse from the Technical University of Delft. He gives a course in Arctic engineering, which I didn't even know as a subject at the time, but it sounded relevant, right? So this was the beginning of a very fruitful cooperation, and we looked at all sorts of parts of the challenge. And in 22, we supervised an excellent master student, Laura van Dijken, and she did all sorts of experiments in a cold room where she would pour salt water on ice and see how it would behave, and then modeling the ice growth. And the results were actually pretty encouraging. So at that time, I still had a full-time job as the CEO of a data analytics company. So this was really my Friday afternoon project, and increasingly also other days of the week. And we discovered this is actually quite an energy-efficient climate intervention, because the amount of sunlight that gets reflected from maintaining an ice cover for 1 month longer is actually 1,000 times larger than the energy that is required for the pumping to get that ice cover. So this made me realize it might actually be possible to preserve the Arctic sea ice by making ice on top of existing ice. And it also turned out that our solution is already featuring in the science fiction novel, The Ministry for the Future. So then I guess it has to work, right? The Arctic is obviously not an ice skating ring. It's like a vast area with very harsh conditions and very low temperatures. So the question is, would it work there and also at such a large scale? But it turns out that ice thickening has been used already for decades in creating ice roads. So for instance, in Canada and Sweden, people create ice roads by thickening them to be able to drive with trucks and supply remote villages. So we can just use existing and proven technology. And ironically, this technique has also been used since the 70s already by oil companies to protect oil drilling rigs with an ice island from all the sea ice that is moving around it. So of course, we have an additional challenge, and that is how to distribute the ice across a very large area. This could, in principle, be done by using millions of small pumping devices and spread them out all over the Arctic, like the original researchers proposed. This is an interesting concept, but we think it's actually more feasible to create about 100 to 1,000 larger pumping sites. And of course, then we need to think about how to distribute the ice from each of these pumping sites. One of the guiding principles that we have is that we want to accelerate natural processes rather than forcing things. In this way, the amount of energy required is also vastly lower. Just like trees capturing carbon from the earth, from the atmosphere, it's vastly more efficient than man-made machinery to do this. And then we realized that for this distribution, we could also make use of a natural process, because the ice actually travels large distances. This can be seen from the Mosaic expedition, which was a research expedition with 300 people from 16 countries, and they froze their ship into the ice and traveled with the ice for more than 1,000 kilometers, doing all sorts of measurements for a whole year. So if we would position our pumping sites at strategic locations in the Arctic, we could actually make use of this natural flow to distribute the ice across a large area and have much more sun reflectivity. Some people ask me, isn't it a bit arrogant to assume we can fix the climate after we as humans have created all this mess? And of course, I think we have every reason to be very modest as a human race. And this is not the ultimate solution to climate change. The most important thing is to rapidly reduce CO2 emissions. But by preventing an ice-free Arctic, we could at least bridge this period until the ice becomes regenerative by itself again. And to ensure that our solution also benefits the local environment, we work together with local indigenous communities to include their knowledge, but also to help them minimize the impact that climate change has on their lives. And I realize this story is a bit technology-oriented. We really love nature, but we're not ecologists or marine biologists or anything. So I'm fully aware that climate engineering techniques like this involve large-scale interventions and potential risks and unintended consequences. And that's why, even at this early research stage, we involve all sorts of different people, stakeholders, ecologists, local indigenous communities, climate scientists, governments, to really ensure that we're very careful. And by taking this multidisciplinary road, I think we can really make balanced and informed decisions in our route along the way. How do we know if the ice really lasts longer? Well, there's only one way to find out, right? And that is to do a field experiment. So we were actually supposed to have gone already with Real Ice, a UK initiative we worked together, to Canadian Arctic, but unfortunately it was too warm and the ice was too unreliable. And this is footage from their previous field test, where you can see the pump in the middle and around that the flooded area. And luckily, we're already planning a field test, a next field test in March at Svalbard, which is north of Norway, where we'll be doing all sorts of experiments and especially look at the influence of salt and of snow. So Svalbard, that's the north of Norway, and there's like a salt water lake connected to a fjord, and it's a very convenient location for this field test because there used to be an old coal mine and there's still some barracks for researchers. And we'll work together with the local researchers and with the University of Delft. And the locals, they really tell us not to cut corners, literally, because there may be a polar bear just around the corner. So we have to protect ourselves from that. And to get there, it's going to be an exciting trip by snow scooter, and we'll stay there for about 7 days of pumping and doing measurements. And afterwards, we will leave remote measurement equipment so that we can also follow the ice growth after that and also the melting season. And by the summer, we aim to openly share our results publicly. And I'm really looking forward to going there, getting all sweaty by shoveling snow and drilling holes through the ice, and then, of course, freeze my nose off while waiting for the pumping. So our mission is unconventional, and it seems a bit crazy, but it's more feasible than you may think. And it's also much needed, because on top of the cure, that is CO2 emission reductions, we also need band-aids, such as Arctic ice thickening, to tackle the climate crisis. So let me ask you, if you could devote your time to something that has been overlooked by many, but you think might have an enormous positive impact, would you at least give it a try? Well, that's great to hear. So, I don't know if this plan is going to work, obviously, but I do know that the vanishing Arctic is a reality we need to confront. And if this doesn't work, maybe we'll find a plan B or a plan C. And I want to inspire positive climate action by others as well. And that will take endurance and perseverance. Just like that moose that was standing up there with his body fully covered in snow and his head stubbornly in the wind. Please join me on this journey to preserve the Arctic. Thank you very much.